Good afternoon. I'm Michelle Young with USF Health, and I'm here today with Dr. Daniel Hoffman.
Thank you, Michelle. It's a pleasure to be
here. New father, third time this week.
Correct.
Exciting week for the family, for the Hoffman family. Dr. Hoffman is a urologist here with USF Health, and he sees patients at Morsani.
At Morsani Center for Advanced Health at the South Tampa Clinic. I operate at Florida Hospital Tampa and the Tampa General Hospital.
Terrific. All right. You sound like you're a busy guy.
Absolutely.
Much. So first of all, let's make sure we tell the viewers that feel free to like, comment, ask questions during this. Let's be honest. This is not a comfortable conversation for women to have with people. We just don't run out in the street and tell people that we have bladder issues or maybe some incontinence. So let's just go ahead and say that you're not alone. We did some research and found that more than 15 million women deal with urinary incontinence, and that 68% of women between 42 and 64 years of age are affected by this.
Absolutely.
And so talk about that.
The impact on their quality of life can be tremendous. It can be very disconcerting when something that you've had control over your entire life gets taken away from you. And certainly there are conditions that can predispose you to having things like leakage of urine, like carrying a pregnancy to term. But there are studies that have demonstrated that regardless of whether you carry a pregnancy, women over the age of 18 will experience, 50% of women over the age of 18 will experience leakage throughout their lifetime, regardless of whether they carry a pregnancy to term.
So let's talk technical and then we'll get into some of the symptoms. Why is this happening to us? Why us?
So, you
talk
know,
a little bit about that.
That's a great question. And incontinence can happen for many different reasons. Typically, the most common cause of leakage in women is a condition called stress urinary incontinence. And it's leakage with activity, like laughing, coughing, sneezing. There are other activities that can cause leakage, like exercise or even things like intercourse. It's because the muscle to the bladder is weak and it can no longer sustain the pressure inside the bladder. So you cough, you sneeze, you lift something heavy up, you leak urine. There is another condition called an overactive bladder that also causes leakage of urine, and it's very different than stress urinary incontinence. It has nothing to do with the muscle holding the urine in the bladder, but rather is a bladder that's squeezing without your permission, constantly causing you to go to the bathroom. And you get the urge to go, and your bladder squeezes without your permission, and you leak urine, and they're treated very differently.
So let's talk a little bit about incontinence first. What are some of the symptoms? I mean, I know maybe if I'm doing jumping jacks, I know we're working out, we got our yoga pants on, we're doing the right thing, and we're doing jumping jacks, and all of a sudden we're like,
that's exactly correct, and that's the symptom, leakage with activity. You have a forceful movement and you will have leakage of urine. That is called stress urinary incontinence. When you have urgency incontinence due to an overactive bladder, the symptom complex is urgent urinations, frequent urinations, getting up at night to go to the bathroom, and leakage of urine with urgency. And that's how you distinguish those two groups.
So what do? We come to see you. What do we have to have surgery? Are you just going to tell us, deal with it? Talk to me a little bit about the types of treatment.
So depending on what condition you have, the therapies, and you can certainly have stress urinary incontinence and an overactive bladder coexisting at the same time. So stress incontinence, you know, is typically a surgical diagnosis. You have to strengthen the outlet. There are non-invasive therapies that you can start with, like pelvic floor physical therapy. Now, I like pelvic floor physical therapy because these are exercises that you do to strengthen the muscle to the bladder and prevent leakage of urine. And it can often improve the degree of leakage, and it may even stop progression of leakage, but seldom will it cure leakage. If you want to cure leakage due to activity, we're talking about surgical procedures to correct the incontinent outlet. These are midurethral slings. These are pieces of fabric that go underneath the urinary tube to prevent leakage of urine. For patients that want to avoid the use of mesh, there are more advanced procedures involving using your own tissues to create a sling for your urinary tube, but it is a more involved process.
So you talk about these exercises. Is this something that we can Google and find online easily?
While there are good videos that you can YouTube on doing exercises at home,
I
would look for Kegels, pelvic floor physical therapy, but like going to the gym with a trainer, there is a benefit to going to a pelvic floor physical therapist because they will help you identify those muscles. They will work in your pelvic floor to make sure that you can identify, relax, and contract those muscles adequately. And then the true benefit comes when you take those lessons and apply them at home on your own. Like going to the gym with a trainer, the benefit comes when you do those exercises repeatedly on your own.
And then come in, have a physical with you, talk about the issues.
And we talk about things are progressing, exactly.
So when is surgery necessary?
Well, for those patients that want a cure to their incontinence, that's when surgery is recommended. The midurethral sling is one of my favorite procedures to do because the impact on quality of life is immediate. It is a minimally invasive procedure. It's a morning at the hospital. And as soon as the sling is in, your incontinence goes away. So the satisfaction for both patient and physician is quite high.
So we're back to doing jumping jacks and
Correct. All
those other things. So
normal physical activity.
When we come in for an initial appointment, what should we prepare for? What should we, to answer questions or?
Well, I have to see the leakage to fix it. So mm-hmm. I do recommend that you come with a comfortably full bladder. And then we may do some exercises to provoke leakage. Mm-hmm. Sometimes if we don't see the leakage, we have to do a test called a urodynamic to see the leakage and assess it, what pressure and volume it occurs to better know how we can fix it.
Okay, and when it's been fixed through medication or surgery or exercise, as you've mentioned some of these exercises, will it come back? Like, how reliable is this treatment?
So if you look at the midurethral sling, this is one of the best studied procedures in urologic literature with over 15 years of data. At initially, the success rate of this procedure exceeds 90% of dry as the definition of cure. And at 5 years, almost 90% efficacy. So you're looking at
really
a pretty good procedure.
Yeah, that's good. So do you think we've covered what we need to with incontinence?
I think so.
Okay, well let's move on to the overactive bladder.
That's a completely different entity.
Is it similar at all? Or?
In the sense that you can leak urine, mm-hmm. but the symptom complex that defines it completely different. This is a patient that's constantly seeking a bathroom because they can't defer the need to go to the bathroom.
They may just go in and tinkle a little bit, or are they going to go a lot?
It's variable, mm-hmm. and it all depends on how much water you're drinking and how active you are. And, you know, you can have these patients that can hold liters in their bladder and go constantly, and patients that can hold ounces in their bladder mm-hmm. and go constantly. And that's when, you know, the history, the physical, all comes into play as to how you're going to treat it.
And so a patient comes in and talks about bladder or urinary incontinence, not urine, the bladder.
The overactive bladder.
The overactive bladder. Sorry, I'm getting mixed up
a little bit.
They come in and they want to talk to you about having this issue. I'm going to pee 10 times a day at work. It's really getting annoying for mm-hmm. me. What kind of exam do you give them and then where do you go from there?
So I always start doing a physical examination and a thorough history that involves quantifying how long this has happened, what the fluid consumption of the patient is, and then we do an internal, like at the gynecologist, make sure that there isn't a polyp around the urinary tube that could be irritating your bladder and causing you to have frequent urinations.
Okay, let's move on and talk a little bit more about bladder infections. What's the cause of bladder infections? Does it always need medication, or are there other things that can...
So, you know, urinary tract infections can heavily impact quality of life, and as our population keeps aging, we see more infections in the aging population. And women are more prone to getting infections than men, and it's because of the way the urinary tract is designed. Men have a very long urinary tube, and it's away from their genitalia, whereas women have a very short urinary tube, and it lives inside of their vagina, which is why it's easy for vaginal bacteria to enter the urinary tract and live inside the bladder, causing recurrent urinary tract infections for women. There are other risk factors for women to developing urinary tract infections like menopause. One of the roles of estrogen is to nurture the lining of the vagina, and when you go through menopause, that lining becomes thin, brittle, and more prone to developing infections. It can cause other symptoms like dryness, vaginal pain, pain with intercourse. So, you know, those are some of the reasons women tend to develop urinary tract infections.
And you want to get something like that treated, not just drink cranberry juice. Well, you want to see a physician.
Absolutely.
Because what can happen if you don't?
You know, untreated urinary tract infections can cause kidney infections, which can cause a condition called sepsis, which can carry a 30% mortality. So it's certainly something that you want to get checked. And while there are women that can carry bacteria in their urine and it's not causing harm, when you have symptoms like burning, nausea, fever, chills, anything to suggest an active infection, you should always seek attention and get treated.
Terrific. And when it's treated, You're done. Symptoms, most of the time it's just medicine?
Symptoms should resolve, and I like to treat the acute event, but then you have to treat the underlying problem.
Mm-hmm.
Is it an estrogen problem? Is there a kidney stone causing urinary tract infections? We always want to find out what the problem is and how we can fix it.
And do you deal with kidney stones as well?
It's one of the things I do as a urologist, okay. Yeah.
Perfect. Ooh. Sound like we could be in business here.
we stay busy.
Your areas of research. I mean, it's great to know that you're a female urologist,
mm-hmm.
because it. When people think of urologists, most of the time you think of men.
Correct.
Or the urologist.
Correct.
You don't think of someone who treats women. So it's great to mm-hmm. know that USF Health has someone that is so qualified. You're bilingual.
Absolutely.
And you
can. Se habla español.
Your areas of research also include urodynamic testing.
Correct.
I have to look that up on here. So talk about that. What does that mean when you talk about that research?
Urodynamic testing is a test of your bladder that really tells me how the bladder works, how it responds to filling, and how it actually empties. When you have issues like leakage, at what volume do you leak? At what pressure do you leak? Sometimes when you have mixed conditions like an overactive bladder and stress urinary incontinence, I have to discern which one is predominant to know how we're going to move forward with therapy. And my area of part of the test involves taking pictures of your bladder, like an x-ray. My area of research focuses on standardizing and minimizing the use of x-ray to make the procedure safer for the patient. Urodynamic tests really do help me better understand how the bladder works and why it's not working adequately to better cater therapy for the patient. And at USF Health, we have a world-class urodynamics lab that competes with any top-notch academic center across the United States.
And that must be a big draw for you.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So we've talked about a number of different issues with the bladder and urinary tract. Are there ways that women can just prevent these issues from happening? Does it have to do with diet? Does it have to do with their weight? Smokers? I mean, what
Another
are some of the
question.
Symptoms?
So like, there certainly are new fancy technologies, laser therapies for the vagina, new medications that we can use to prevent infections, but I like to think of simple things that you can do to prevent infections, right? You can certainly make your urine more acidic by taking things like vitamin C, and that makes it harder for bacteria to grow. You can drink things like cranberry supplements, which fight bacteria like E. coli and make it harder for them to attach to the urinary tract. You can take things like probiotics, the good bacteria, the healthy bacteria that prevent bad bacteria like E. coli from colonizing the vagina and the urinary tract. So certainly there are a lot of simple modifications that you can do in your day-to-day life that will improve your overall quality of health.
So cranberry juice isn't a myth.
It is not.
It's something that you're definitely a thumbs up.
I'm a big fan.
Yeah, and I've never heard vitamin C. That's really interesting.
Yep.
So terrific. So Lisa, do we have any questions?
We just had the one here about incontinence and the elderly. Is there an age range where they can still seek treatment, or it seems like maybe a misconception?
That is a great question, and there is no age limit. The only thing that determines whether you should seek therapy is bother. If you're bothered by your symptoms, come talk to me. No one in today's day and age should live leaking urine. And it's something that we can treat or at least make better. So if you are bothered by your symptoms, please come seek help.
Yeah, no, like I said at the beginning, there's 15 million women that suffer from this. And
Absolutely.
So there's that many people out there. 68% of the people between 42 and 64.
It's a populational problem.
It's a population problem, and it doesn't just pick on one person. It picks on...
It's indiscriminate.
Yeah.
I agree.
Yeah, terrific. Well, Dr. Hoffman, you've been fantastic.
Thank you so
much.
We
really appreciate you joining us.
Thank you for having
me. And remind us again where we can get in touch with you and where we can get appointments.
I see patients at the South Tampa Clinic and at the Morsani Center for Advanced Healthcare and Florida Hospital Tampa and Tampa General Hospital.
Terrific. Good luck with the new baby.
Thank you.
And I'm sure the two siblings at home are excited to welcome the baby. So thank you.
Thank you.